Thank you. How amazing was that? Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Kia ora, everyone. My name is Stephen Logan, and this is the Auckland Concert Orchestra. Let's give them one more big round of applause. Now, the orchestra that you see before you today is made up of, you know them, you love them, the Auckland Youth Orchestra, who are celebrating their 75th anniversary. And to become the Auckland Concert Orchestra, they are being joined by a number of their distinguished alumni and guests. And of course, they're being helmed by none other than the man himself, Maestro Anton Polianich. There he is. So, I don't think I need to tell anyone that that was the music from Star Wars. So, written by John Williams, the first Star Wars film came out in 1977. And now, John Williams is the second most Academy Award nominated person in history. He has 53 Academy Award nominations, and the only person that has more than that is, of course, Walt Disney, who has 59. Now, John Williams wound up winning 5 Academy Awards. One of them, of course, was for Star Wars. And I've got to tell you something about myself for a second, is that I'm a huge nerd, and I love this music, and I want to tell you why. So when John Williams wrote this score in 1977, film music was starting to move away from acoustic instruments and into more digital instruments like synthesizers. But he did a lot of work to bring back the orchestral sound into films. And there are two big things that I think of in how he did this. One of them is about a century before, there was a composer, Richard Wagner, who was writing big operas like the Ring Cycle. I'm sure some of you may have heard of Ride of the Valkyries, things like that. And he used this technique that was called leitmotifs, where every time you had a specific character come onto the stage, whether it was Siegfried or Brunhilde, they would come out and you would hear a specific motive that was associated with that character. So you really knew who you were dealing with. John Williams does something very similar with Star Wars. So that was, of course, the main titles. But coming up in not the next piece, which I'll introduce in a second, but the one after that, you're going to hear Princess Leia's theme. Back on the second half, you're going to hear Darth Vader's theme and Yoda's theme. And notice how with each one of these themes, you instantly know, you can picture this character in your head. You know exactly who this music is about, because that's the power of the way John Williams has written this music for these characters. Now, another thing that I want to tell you about that for me makes this genius is, so I'm a timpanist. I'm the timpanist in the APO. And my friend Caleb Goldsmith is up there playing timpani tonight. And one of the things that's really awesome about these scores is John Williams has these layers. So at the beginning of that, we all recognize the theme, right? Right? And but I bet you don't realize that there's this amazing music that's going on underneath. And so it's played by Caleb on the timpani, the low brass section, but I'm going to make Caleb play it for a second because, so John Williams, his father was a percussionist in the CBS Radio Orchestra, so he was very, very familiar with how timpani and percussion worked. And in fact, in the 1977 London Symphony Orchestra recording of the soundtrack, it's actually his brother Don Williams who's playing the part. And the great part is it really pushes the limits of what a timpanist can do. And that's why I'm putting you in the capable hands of Caleb Goldsmith to play the opening that you may not have noticed the first time. Take it away, Caleb. For Caleb Goldsmith, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Caleb. So, moving on, before we get to Princess Leia's theme, the next piece of music you're going to hear is from a film called Schindler's List. Now, when Steven Spielberg decided to make this film, it was incredibly important to him. Steven Spielberg himself and his family are Jewish, and it, of course, tells the story of a group of Jewish people in the Holocaust who went to work in a factory for a man named Oscar Schindler and wound up being saved from all the atrocities that were World War II. So this was definitely something really important to Spielberg, and he came to John Williams. They had this long-time collaboration at this point, and he said, I really need a great score for this. And John Williams was very nervous about writing it. And in fact, he said to him right away, he thought about it, and he said, Steven, you need a better composer for this. I can't do this. And Steven Spielberg famously said back to him, you're right, but they're all dead, so I need you to do this for me. So, to play one of the movements from the orchestral suite from Schindler's List, we're going to bring up the fantastic Mr. Jim Wu on the violin to play. I'll see you all soon. So what did I tell you? You could definitely hear Princess Leia there, right? How fantastic was that? So we're going to move out of John Williams land now. And we're going to, the next two pieces that we have in the program, the first one is written by Ennio Morricone. So the film that this is from is called The Mission. And in The Mission, there is a Jesuit priest, Father Gabriel, who is, let's say, going into a territory where the people he's going to interact with may have killed one of his brothers shortly before. So his idea to make sure that he doesn't die and pacify the situation is to bring his oboe and play a theme. And here it's been adapted into the form of a song called Nella, Fantasia, which I'm pretty sure is the right pronunciation because I just got Tayla Alexander to tell me how backstage. But so the compositional style of this is going to be very different from the piece of music that you hear after it, which is from Pirates of the Caribbean. So when Ennio Morricone was writing this film, his background is he's Italian, and he started writing films in 1961. He went on to write over 400 films, which is crazy because he's also someone that would write every single note that the violins or the basses or the timpani or the trombones that everyone would play, he would write every single note. And of course, one of his most famous collaborations was, you know, if Steven Spielberg and John Williams were always working together and Ennio Morricone was always working with Sergio Leone, you may recognize he is a trumpet player, so he had a spectacular theme for the Man with No Name trilogy with Clint Eastwood, where it goes, wah, wah, wah. Yeah, you know the one. Well, this is not that, but so Ennio Morricone wrote over 400 film scores, and again, he wrote every single note, which is crazy with what I'm about to tell you. So after you hear this wonderful piece of music, you're going to hear Pirates of the Caribbean. Now, the way this worked was Hans Zimmer sat down one night and he wrote the three biggest themes that were going to be used in the film on the piano. The only problem was they only had 3 weeks from that night to when the music needed to start to be edited into the film. So what they did was Jerry Bruckheimer, the producer, and the studio wound up bringing in 7 additional composers to help Hans Zimmer to orchestrate the score and get the whole film music from beginning to end. And then it had to all be recorded in just 4 days, which is, again, it's just crazy. So consider that Morricone wrote the whole, every single note for 400 films, and when you hear Pirates of the Caribbean, it really took a village. It took a whole team of people to pull this off. But to come out here and sing for you the Morricone, the spectacular, the best-dressed person in the room, Miss Tayla Alexander.
Pieno manit Fantasia esiste un vento caldo che soffia sulle città come amico. Io sogno d'anime che sogno sempre libere.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. Really quickly before we start, I just want to share a story. And yes, I'm about to shamelessly name drop because this was one of the coolest moments of my life. So I've had the opportunity to work with John Williams conducting from the podium. And it's such a cool experience because, okay, so John Williams, when you stand next to him, he's actually only like this tall. And, you know, Hollywood is full of lots of big personalities, but John Williams is just a lovely human being, and he's really soft-spoken, and he's not that. So whenever he goes to count in a piece, he's really soft-spoken, and he goes, so. And I want you to imagine that that is what you hear right before you hear this. Pretty exciting, right? Okay, so I want to talk to you really quick about the experience of performing on a film soundtrack recording, because I think it's a little different than most people assume. So you wouldn't know it, because these are spectacular musicians, but these parts are really hard. They're really, really hard. So you'd think that the musicians would have tons of time to rehearse together and get to perform together and then do the recording session. No, because time is money in Hollywood, of course. So the way it works is you get an email from a contractor, and the contractor says, hi, we'd like to book you for this recording session on this day. This is the instrument that you're going to play. And, of course, most times they can't tell you what the film is. You know, sometimes there's fake names that they'll use. I think when they were filming, either Black Panther or Wakanda Forever, they were using the name Spring Break, something like that, just to totally throw you off. So you show up, they tell you, okay, the recording session's from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. So if you're me, you get there as early as you possibly can so that the second they open the door, you walk in, the music's on the stand, and you have until 10 a.m. when the rehearsals or when the recording starts to make sure that you can frantically learn all of those notes and do it really fast. So it all happens at a breakneck speed, and it really takes an exceptional group of musicians to be able to do these sorts of things. So it's 1991. Steven Spielberg has just finished production on Hook. And now he finds his moment. It is time. He's had the idea of making Schindler's List for a decade. It's time to do it. He's ready to do it. There's one problem, though. The studio is a little nervous about taking a bet on an R-rated film about the Holocaust. They were worried that they wouldn't get the ticket sales to, make their budget. So they struck a deal with Steven Spielberg. They said, "We want you to make Jurassic Park. And if you make Jurassic Park, because we really think that's going to be a big hit, it's going to be a blockbuster, you make Jurassic Park for us, you can make Schindler's List." And now what that meant was it was a really tight schedule. So Steven Spielberg was in Poland filming Schindler's List, and after he would get done filming, he would call back to Industrial Light and Magic, which is George Lucas's special effects company, which was founded in Star Wars, to oversee the post-production of Jurassic Park. And actually, the story is that, on Hook, it was Robin Williams that was playing Peter Pan, so he and Steven Spielberg got very close. So when Steven Spielberg got particularly down, Robin Williams would call him and tell him jokes for 15 minutes to try to help him feel better. We all have our methods. But anyway, so the turnaround time on Schindler's List was very fast. And I've already told you about John Williams' hesitations with writing the music for it. So you can imagine he had a really small period of time to write this music. But what's great is I mentioned before that John Williams won 5 Academy Awards. One of them is for Star Wars. Another one is for Schindler's List. So up next, you're going to hear another one of these iconic themes from Star Wars. That's Yoda's theme. And then after that, we're going to bring back up the amazing Mr. Jim Wu on the violin to play the remaining 2 movements from John Williams' orchestral suite from Schindler's List. I'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Jim Wu, ladies and gentlemen. So, next, we're going to go back from John Williams to Ennio Morricone. So, we're all from somewhere. We all have a place that is home for us. And inevitably, we all eventually move away from that place, whether it's 5 minutes down the street, maybe it's just next door, maybe it's down to the basement instead, or maybe it's to the other side of the world. As you can probably tell from how I've been talking for the last 2 hours, I'm American, so, you know, I came to the other side of the world for me. But eventually we all return. And as we get older and as we have new experiences and we come back and we see these places with fresh eyes, there's just this nostalgia, this things have happened here. And that's really what the film Cinema Paradiso is about. So at the beginning, the local projectionist in a small town in Sicily passes away. And Salvatore, who is now away from the city and an acclaimed film director, comes back home to this small town in Sicily for the funeral. But it winds up becoming very complicated. And he realizes how much of his life was really shaped by the friendship that he had with Alberto and the cinema that he would watch, from going to hang out with him and sitting up in the projectionist room and watching all the films as they came through. So when Morricone wrote this score, I have no doubt that you'll, as soon as you hear the music, you'll see what I mean. I remember the first time that I heard this music, everything that I just said, I felt it, even though I heard the music before I saw the film. And you just tell me you listen to this piece of music and you don't feel that feeling. So what will be coming up next is, it's the title is Se. Again, I just got a pronunciation coaching from Tayla Alexander backstage, who will be singing it. After that, you're going to get to hear the theme from My Neighbor Totoro. So, another film that changes over time. You know, when you watch Totoro as a child, you look at it a certain way, and the older you get, you begin to interpret the characters in the film differently. So the composer for Totoro is a man named Joe Hisaishi, and Hisaishi took a different approach than John Williams. So we talked earlier about John Williams created these really, really unique motives for every single character. Hisaishi had the mindset that he wanted each of his films to have a really clear, strong theme. So that if you saw the poster for the film, you would immediately hear that theme. And for anyone that has seen the film, let's say you haven't heard the music in a while, you're going to remember it the second the orchestra starts playing it. So after that, we're going to return to John Williams, because of course you can't come this far in the Star Wars suite and not do the throne room and the end credits. And I'll see you after that. But first, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring back out Miss Tayla Alexander.
Potresti avere un'idea di ciò che sento.
Dunque mi stende si è mette
Ladies and gentlemen, how amazing is the Auckland Concert Orchestra? Absolutely amazing, so much so that I bet we're all excited enough that even though we have reached the end of the program, we'd love to hear at least one more piece of music, right? Yes. We're all excited to hear one more piece of music. And you know, if you're really excited, you can channel that excitement in a very healthy way. You can pull out your phones. You can go to ayo.org.nz. And if you scroll down just a little bit, there's a little red button that says donate. And you can channel your excitement that way. So before I leave you, the next time that you'll have the opportunity to see this wonderful group of musicians is on the 14th, 15th, and 20th of October. On the 20th of October, they'll be back here, right here on stage at the Auckland Town Hall for Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. I mean, it doesn't get more recognizable than that after John Williams, right? So you can all come and see that. And before I let you go, though, we're going to now move into a piece of music by someone who's not necessarily known for his film music, but more for his concert works, Dmitri Shostakovich. So in 1955, Dmitri Shostakovich wrote music for a film called The First Echelon, and it included his Waltz No. 2. Now, of course, some of you may not know that film. It's Russian. It's from 1955. So maybe you'll recognize it from Stanley Kubrick's Eyes Wide Shut, starring Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I'm Steve Logan. This is Maestro Anton Polianich. Thank you to Tayla Alexander and Jim Wu. And also, you have a special guest for the Waltz No. 2 who snuck in, and I worked very hard. I'm going to pronounce his name right. Arvydas Kozlauskas. I did it. Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the show and your evening.